Welcome to the Thoughtful Software Podcast. My name is Fahad Chokat, and joining me is Andrew Wolf, CEO of SkipList. This podcast is all about building incredible and thoughtful software. So in this episode, we talk with Natasha Takahashi from School of Bots. If you ever wanted to know about bots, she is the best person to talk to. Just a tremendous amount of passion and energy around this topic, and she's always very helpful and informative. We get into all things chatbots, like things like where to start, build custom, or something off the shelf. What do people get wrong about bots? And chatbot trends for 2019, plus a bunch of other topics. So we hope you find it informative. I hope you enjoy. Here we go.
You know, we know there's just so much bad software out there, and we don't want to talk about the bad stuff. We want to talk about what the future could look like when you build great software. And so we're always interested in technology that kind of fits the, not fits, but, you know, it has that thoughtfulness mm-hmm. into it. And so one of the things that I've always been fascinated by is chatbots. And so when I saw kind of some of the things that you're working on, I was like, who would be better than you to talk about how to build a really good chatbot, a thoughtful chatbot? So, you know, that's some of the things we can talk about. But I think it would be interesting to maybe from the beginning, just to kind of start off and tell us, how'd you get into School of Bots? What is it?
In terms of what I'm working on right now in the bot space, School of Bots is my main company at the moment. Although I do a variety of different things, as I think I kind of told you, Fahad, last time that we caught up after so long. So I got into the bot space almost 3 years ago. So it hasn't been long, but so many things have changed at such a rapid pace that it feels like I've been in it for like 10 years. It's like, you know, things are just moving so, so quickly, as I'm sure you guys can understand from just tech in general. So I got into the bot space primarily when Facebook Messenger actually opened up their API and chatbots started appearing on that platform. And it was because I was already in like the Facebook marketing and digital marketing worlds that I even actually considered working with chatbots, which is funny enough. I almost totally passed up the opportunity to get into the space. And so started a agency around the service of providing Facebook Messenger chatbots to businesses from small business to enterprise. We really worked with a variety of different companies because I saw the power of them, but it was just so early on that it was really tough to say what they could really be useful for in business, right? You know, what use cases would be useful? And all those questions were really unanswered because up until then, it'd been, you know, Slack chatbots or Skype bots, Kick, that weren't really B2C or even B2B. It was mainly just internal kind of like management of teams, which is cool. It's kind of like an assistant, you know, and almost like a HR person being available to you as well, letting you know and onboarding you to a new team. But other than that, there weren't really any other applications. So I entered the space fairly early on in terms of actual business use cases. And over the last 2.5 years, we've done almost 100 chatbot projects for all sorts of different industries. I think almost 22 industries now, and all sorts of different company sizes as well. And from that, about a year ago, we realized, my co-founder and I, Kyle Willis, realized that there wasn't really a go-to educator for the specific topics that we were working in. So there are a lot of, you know, machine learning white papers and experts on, you know, deep AI and all of that, but there wasn't really anyone who you could go to online, any website, forum, any of that stuff, that would tell you how do you use chatbots in the marketing and business sense, in that, you know, how can they support marketing, operations, and sales for a business at a practical, you know, standpoint, and not so much just the deep stuff that's going to come, you know, in many years from now, honestly, since it's just in its infancy. And so we decided to found School of Bots, which its ultimate goal is to be the one-stop shop for all things chatbots. That's our motto, really, and to be able to provide education and training and a lot of content for people on chatbot building, marketing, monetization, as well as sales, because there are so many businesses that don't have a chatbot yet, and so there's a lot of opportunity for these new chatbot agencies to support these businesses and help them get a chatbot up and running and be able to manage it for them the same way that you would hire a ads agency or a PR agency or any sort of digital marketing agency. efficiency. So that's the bulk of our work right now, is training and educating, but we are also still creating chatbots. So I've got quite a lot going on in terms of all the different areas of bots that I'm currently working.
Do you focus mostly on enterprises, or is it a particular startups? Who's kind of driving your business?
Yeah, so for us, what ended up happening with the there's two businesses, I'll kind of address the two audiences there. Because for our agency, what ended up happening at the beginning was that it was such a new technology that we ended up partnering with a couple other agencies who already had their niches. They already had their specific audience that they were serving. And so we ended up doing a lot of white label bot work for each of these agencies. So our audience pool or our client pool turned into a variety and assortment of all sorts of different company sizes, like you mentioned, startup to enterprise, as well as different industries. And although typically I wouldn't recommend any service-based business to do that, it actually really helped us progress a lot faster, I'd say, than most of the other chatbot agencies that I know, just because we are able to experiment so much more in so many different spaces, as opposed to just kind of confining ourselves to one industry and one specific company size. And as for School of Bots, we mainly focus on helping marketers who want to add this service to their current agency or want to learn how to create profitable campaigns with chatbots. Because that's the one thing that people are struggling with, is it's very easy to set up, in specific a Facebook Messenger chatbot. There are platforms that let you do it in a couple seconds. But in terms of actually making it generate results and creating something that's exciting for the user to go through, that takes a lot more practice and time. And so that's what we're really helping people understand and learn, is to be able to create those campaigns, create that content and that user experience that actually engages people and is valuable for both the consumer and the business.
Are bots considered like a really big project? Like I know it's very strategic, but like just in terms of the work of deploying a bot, putting all this together, is that considered a pretty heavy project for an enterprise?
For an enterprise, yes. For a small business, no, although it will eventually become a bigger project, because the way that in terms of background info, there's no like best practice or specific standard procedure for how businesses are doing this right now, since it's so new. So the answers I'm giving you are really just from my own experience and how we do things. But at our agency, what we tend to do is approach chatbots from a very strategical standpoint, where we say we want to implement, you know, these specific use cases over the next 6 months, right? And then from there, we can focus on actually improving everything and, you know, adding more use cases if we want to. But so we look at it as a longer timeline than most chatbot agencies do, I think. And so from that standpoint, it's easy to get it up and running, and we start with one use case, really hone in on that, and then from there grow. So it is a long project, but ultimately that's the best way we've found it. Otherwise, if you try to do too much at the beginning, it gets a little hectic. And as for enterprise, same thing, because what ends up happening is with a chatbot, use cases and possibilities are really endless, but it all comes down to how to actually execute it. And the problem with enterprise and just companies who have a lot of different departments or different teams handling a lot of different areas of the business is that we oftentimes have to involve almost every department in terms of like marketing, customer support, and sales, just because we need to know how they work and how the chatbot can take over certain workflows or be implemented into some of their workflows. So it is a pretty time-heavy project where it can take, you know, 12 months to implement an enterprise chatbot, which is typical timeline anyways, I think, for a lot of enterprise projects
so
in general.
So when you're looking at chatbots, are you building them in-house or are you using off-the-shelf software? And then depending on what you're doing, because you probably do a mixture of both or want to do a mixture of both, how do you make that differentiation when you're talking to a client?
Yeah, so for us at this point, we do use off-the-shelf software, although it's pretty complex, I will say, and there's a lot that you can do, even if you're non-technical, like if you're just wanting to get into the space, there's a lot that you can do with codeless platforms that allow you to pretty much do anything that you could want to do inside of a bot without having to code a single line. So some of those platforms are ManyChat, ChatFuel, Zapier, and Integromat. So ManyChat and ChatFuel are the actual platform that connect you to a Facebook page. At the moment, that's the only platform that they do is Facebook Messenger, but in the future, they're already expanding in 2019. And so with that, it's very easy to get set up on those platforms. And the reason that we use them is because they have already created such a great relationship with Facebook that it makes a lot more sense to build a bot on those platforms and have that be the initial touch point between the bot and a Facebook page, which is where the bot is hosted on Facebook, rather than trying to code it yourself. And the reason is because the review time, if anyone listening is familiar with Facebook apps, you typically have to go through this review period. And the review period, if you code the entire bot and submit it on your own, you know, as a developer, can be several weeks, months. You know, it really depends on what the chatbot looks like. Whereas with ManyChat and ChatFuel, it's actually an instantaneous connection. You literally just select your Facebook page that you want to connect a bot to from a list, and you're connected. So the running time and the timeline of the project dramatically decreases when you use these platforms. And then these platforms also have open APIs so that you could create anything custom that you would have wanted to code yourself while still having that instantaneous connection, as well as great relationship with Facebook, as well as the communities that these platforms have created for the projects and industry. So that's what we do at this point for all of the projects that we build. And then the other two platforms I mentioned, Zapier and Integromat, they allow us to do a lot of the API integrations we would usually code without any coding at all. So they pretty much allow you to connect ManyChat and ChatFuel to Salesforce, to ActiveCampaign, to any CRM or email marketing software you want, you know, to Google Sheets, to pretty much any, almost any software platform you can think of. They have a connection there so that you can link your chatbot to those platforms and transfer data, as well as, you know, use conditional logic and things like that to personalize an experience for someone inside of the chatbot itself.
So speaking of Facebook, they seem to be in a little bit of trouble recently. And there's quite a few people kind of jumping off their platform and switching to something else like Instagram, or, you know, there's, I don't know how many different chatbot platforms out there. How does like in a startup or an enterprise kind of maintain, you know, the latest and greatest platforms and shifting from one to Facebook, to WhatsApp, to Instagram? You know, if let's say you're an e-commerce type company, you want to be on every single platform. Right. What's a good strategy for that?
The reason that we start with Facebook Messenger for all of our clients is because that's where best business to consumer conversations are happening. For B2B, it's a little bit different, but for B2C and just talking about the messaging platforms, as you mentioned, WhatsApp is a great example as well, and Instagram, those two platforms don't enable you to do as much inside of the chatbot as Facebook Messenger does. Oh. And even as in a conversation between users, actually, if you go into Facebook Messenger, if you haven't looked at it in some time, for those of you guys who are listening, I would suggest that you go into it, and at the bottom left corner of any conversation, you'll actually see a lot of different extensions, is what they call them. And so you can actually create a Spotify like playlist with friends, you can create event reminders, you can create polls, you can create all these different things, and all of that is just simply not available yet in almost any other messaging platform. So that's one of the advantages, is that Messenger allows you to do a lot more in terms of functionality. And, you know, that also allows you to have more flexible business goals with a chatbot. And on top of that, I'd say, like, in terms of going back to your question, in terms of a strategy, I'd say Facebook Messenger is probably the best place to start. And then from there, of course, you would want to expand. But because the state of the other messaging platforms just isn't at the state of Messenger, and Messenger owns Instagram and WhatsApp anyways, so I'm sure that what they're doing with Messenger now is going to eventually be applied to Instagram and WhatsApp. So I would suggest starting with Messenger, unless you are B2B, then I can talk about that in a second. And then once you are creating results with Messenger, then everything that you have discovered along the way in terms of creating a great user experience, the artificial intelligence side of things, actually figuring out what users want to engage with in terms of content inside of the chatbot, all of that can be applied to any other channel you choose to pursue.
You know, I find that really interesting. So I think chatbots, what I'm excited about is, you know, the analytics that you gain from these conversations.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. And like, I'd be interested in what are some of the limitations there? Like, for example, like intelligent systems, they don't do very good job of like, you know, reasoning. But, you know, maybe a recommendation or like detecting something like, but where do you see kind of the intelligence coming into this?
Yeah. So right now it's in such infancy for Facebook Messenger, honestly, that it's tough to tell what that timeline will look like. I will say the one platform that is really pushing this forward is actually Google's Dialogflow. So for those of you guys who are not familiar with it, it's an AI engine that can actually be plugged into almost any messaging platform and actually trains itself to become smarter, more intelligent. Whereas a lot of the messaging platforms, or rather the bot building platforms, like ManyChat and ChatFuel, which I mentioned, they don't actually have great AI systems set up yet. So you cannot actually train artificial intelligence or do any of the fancy machine learning stuff you can do with other chatbots, you know, that don't exist on Facebook Messenger, because they have set it up to be a little bit more static, to where you set up the AI based on specific phrases and terms, but the bot does not learn from that. So, you know, you could say if someone says help or support, you know, then the bot says this, but that's the extent of what it'll do. So it doesn't actually learn from its conversations. Whereas if you can tie in Dialogflow, and there are a couple other ones, but Dialogflow is proven to be the most popular so far, that actually allows you to train the bot. But not everyone is using it. Dialogflow is a little bit more of a technical platform, so it's not ideal for people who are non-technical, which honestly is starting to become a lot of the marketers or businesses to try to use Facebook Messenger bots. So people do have to keep it, you know, non-technical friendly. And so it's difficult to implement platforms like that. And I think that's what's slowing the growth of intelligence for these types of bots, is just the accessibility.
Can you combine things like Dialogflow and then Messenger? You know, they're two different companies and platforms, but if you wanted to add intelligence to a Facebook bot or something like that, is that possible?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's kind of what I was hinting at, is that what you can do is actually have a three-part relationship between ManyChat or ChatFuel. ManyChat or ChatFuel do the same thing, by the way. So either one of those connected to a Facebook page, and then Dialogflow connected to that page as well. And so that enables you to have the chatbot content, the campaigns, any sort of actual building that you want to do of the chatbot experience can happen inside of ManyChat and ChatFuel. And then the actual artificial intelligence training of the bot happens in Dialogflow. And you can have that connection pretty much be seamless between the three platforms.
You mentioned marketers, you know, people that are mainly non-technical jumping into the in bots. And what is a few or one thing that people get wrong about bots that you've kind of had to, you know, correct or educate people about?
I think the main thing, or the first thing that happens when someone finds out about chatbots, once they understand what it is, because sometimes people are just like, oh, I don't get that, that sounds crazy or complicated, so I'm just going to ignore it. But for the people who do understand what it looks like and what they could do with it, they start to get really, really excited and really hyped up, you know, on all the amazing things you can do and all the connections you can have, you know, between other platforms and all the complexities. And so they try to develop way too many things inside of the chatbot too fast. So I would say the one thing that people get wrong is just trying to implement too much too soon. And so that goes back to the strategy that I mentioned before that we typically implement at our agency, is that anytime we approach a chatbot project, we're going to think about the timeline and exactly when we want to implement certain features. Because if you let a chatbot, you know, walk you through, for an e-commerce, to kind of go back to your e-commerce example, you know, you could provide a gift guide for a user who comes in and try to help them choose a product to purchase. You could be running all these different sales and discount campaigns. You know, Black Friday and Cyber Monday just happened, so that's a great example of that. You could be trying to automate customer support and do all of these different things, but unless you have a huge team who can manage all of this, which oftentimes just doesn't happen right now with bots because it's so new, people just aren't familiar with all the processes and procedures and everything they have to put together. Like, it's way too much to manage all at once. And then you've got all these live messages coming in every day and you need to analyze them, as you said. And so it's really difficult to do all of that at once. And so people don't see that many great results because they haven't focused on making each functionality, you know, actually seamless and exciting for the user. So I'd say that's a number one thing. And there's a lot of other things that happen too, from policy, you know, or from breaking certain policies to, you know, not understanding or not making it conversational and fun. But overall, that's the number one thing I see, is that people just try to
How do you do that? How do you build in fun into a chatbot?
Yeah. So I think the main thing that affects the fun of an experience would be the personality of the bot and what it does along with that. And that's something that people don't really think about, or a lot of the marketers don't think about, because a lot of the bots that exist right now either sound like an overly excited, like customer service rep or something, where every message, it feels really unnatural because they're using like 5 different exclamation points and all these emojis. And you would usually not get a message like that from a friend, right? It feels a little bit unnatural and like invasive almost. So that's a mistake that a lot of people make in terms of the personality and kind of fostering or nurturing that relationship.
Let me ask you about that. What is your opinion on that? Should the user know that they're talking to a bot?
Yes, they need to actually. By California law, if a chatbot has a certain number of users, I think it is. I haven't looked at it in a couple months, so I need to revisit that. But if it's a certain number of users, or if it has a certain amount of influence in terms of who it can reach, the chatbot has to explicitly say, you know, I'm an automated system or something like that, just to make it really explicit for users. Yeah. So you definitely want to do that anyways, because then users are confused or upset that like the human isn't understanding what they're saying or not getting back to them. Cause like I said, the AI is pretty limited. So a chatbot could send something called like the default reply, or kind of like the fallback, right? If it doesn't understand something, and a user would be super confused if they thought that was a human, right? Cause it would just keep saying, oh, I don't understand what you're saying. And they'd get frustrated and leave. So it is really important to mention that. We don't explicitly say like, hey, I'm a chatbot and this is what a chatbot is. But we do say something like, hey, I'm the assistant, or, you know, I'll be guiding you around today, but if you need to talk to a human, you know, then here's how you can do that, just to make it explicit to them in that way.
It probably makes that handoff easier then. So it's like, okay, I need to hand it off to somebody because I'm
that. Mm-hmm. Andrew, go ahead.
One thing that I'm picking up that wasn't explicitly said, but wanted to talk about, was you see a lot of companies rolling out cost saving bots. Banking, you see a lot of banking bots, and that's probably the most prolific. But even hospitals are rolling them out to like try to pre-diagnose people, though they're really awful. But the chatbot to make revenue per se, like marketing and sales, is really an interesting move on it. Do you see like a personal assistant? Are people using these as a personal assistant to shop, like Black Friday? Hey, I want a gift for someone that likes speakers, and it says, hey, check these out. Do you see that a lot? And as intelligence gets, I guess, gets there, right? AI is still relatively in its infancy. Do you believe people like Amazon will adopt them to help people navigate their sites and their portfolio of products better?
Yes, I definitely do. And that's actually already working pretty well, because one of the things that Facebook Messenger was quick to add was a integration with any website, to where if you go actually to a lot of websites for like big brands who have like smaller brands under them, a lot of them are experimenting right now with that, where in the bottom right corner of a website, similar to where you would find a, you know, live chat kind of little window that says, hey, have any questions? You can actually do the same thing with Facebook Messenger now. And so a lot of businesses are experimenting with having a bot, you know, onboard or guide someone through their offers. But going back to the idea actually that you mentioned about gift guide, or, you know, someone kind of taking you through almost like a concierge would, you know, when you walk into a store to kind of help you pick out the perfect gift or help you figure out what product works for you, that is doing incredibly well as a use case for marketing, and then obviously leading into the sale. And two great examples of that are Lego's chatbot on Facebook Messenger. If you just look up their Facebook page, the general Lego page has the largest amount of followers, and you message them, it'll actually take you through choosing a gift, you know, for your kid pretty much. So it'll take you through that, and they do such a great job with images and the terminology, and like the words that they use has given the bot such a great personality that I'd say that's probably the best experience to look at as the most successful right now. The other example would be for Saks Fifth Avenue. The only problem with theirs is that it's a little bit dry and it's really not that exciting or engaging to go through. And also Saks is pretty exclusive in terms of their pricing, right? I think some of the lowest stuff that I was seeing on like the gift guide was like $400, right? So that's obviously not going to be for your average consumer. And so that experience wasn't as exciting for me to personally go through, but the Lego one I think is one that can resonate with most people. And you can see how that's being done from some of the best, because they have been doing this, I think, for about a year now. They've had this gift guide on their Messenger page. And this, actually, I don't know the numbers off the top of my head, but they've got the case study on Facebook. They've got it on chatfuel.com and a couple other spots. So you guys can see the stats and just crazy results that they've gotten with this specific use case.
I want to go back to intelligence for a minute too. So as they do get more intelligent chatbots and AI starts getting there, you're going to see probably a proliferation. One obvious use case is like a travel, artificial travel agent.
Yes.
I'm sure they're
working on that. Can't wait for that.
It would save me a lot of time personally. But how do we, you know, one of our things here at Skipless is being thoughtful, and making money is great and all of that. But how can businesses be thoughtful in how they roll these out to their users? Because ultimately, you know, we are a, you know, very social animal, humans are. And so losing that social interaction I get when I call my real travel agent or just whoever's on the other side of the Expedia hotline, then how do we make chatbots be thoughtful for our users? Not just the businesses who are going to drive massive revenue from them, but the people that are going to consume your products and services through these chatbots.
Yeah, I think there's two main things that come to mind. The first goes along with the point that, or rather the theme that I've kind of been reiterating, which is to roll things out slowly, because that gives you the opportunity as the business to not rush into it and try to just, you know, make it useful for you, but also take the time to see how users interact with the chatbot and actually have this more productive cycle of, you know, analyze, execute, where you can actually see how users are interacting with the bot and then implement what you've learned from that into the chatbot's next use case, which a lot of businesses just are not doing, unfortunately. So I'd say that's one way to be most thoughtful about the whole process, is actually use feedback and the experiences that you're able to observe, unlike anything else you can observe, right? Because you can't really observe your users going through an email. That's just usually not possible. But with a bot, you can actually see every point of the conversation, and based on the options that you give users, you can also see how someone's feeling, or, you know, what they're doing, and based on what they type as well, right? It's a very personal and intimate experience. And so the ability to analyze that is huge, and to take that and then implement back what you learn into the bot is the best way to be thoughtful. And then the other way I would say, in terms of like just kind of keeping the user in mind at all points, is the onboarding experience for a chatbot. So with Facebook Messenger, and honestly with any platform, it's going to be a little bit different, right? Just because of the interface and, you know, what options users have available to them. But the onboarding that someone experiences as soon as they start talking to the bot is really, really important, because that determines and lays the foundation for how a user is going to proceed, if they're going to come back to the bot at a later time, or if that first impression is such a bad experience that they no longer want to talk to bots and are kind of hesitant, you know, if they approach another bot or see a bot message in their inbox. So that onboarding process is really important, and it looks different for every company. It depends on what the chatbot does, but usually I'd say an outline of that would be telling the user what the chatbot does, explicitly making sure that the user knows this is an assistant, you know, an automation, not a human, as well as how to start a conversation over or go to some sort of main menu so that the user can continue to direct their experience. Because depending on what's happening inside of the chatbot, you know, if the chatbot's not understanding what the user's saying, or perhaps the chatbot had a technical issue or something happened, you know, how do they go back to somewhere where they can start over, whether it's a menu or talking to a human, you know, so introducing them to how to do that inside of the conversation is important. And I'd say those are probably the two main ways right now that you can be thoughtful when approaching, building, and then executing a chatbot.
So if somebody has a bad experience within chatbots, like how are you capturing that feedback? And I'm really interested in the analytics. Yeah. Like, okay, if there's a bad experience or that wasn't the right recommendation, how do companies actually understand, okay, this wasn't the right thing, mm-hmm. and then make a decision on that?
Yeah. So one or two of the main ways that you can do it are through Dialogflow, the platform that I mentioned before. It can actually capture certain sentiments, like say someone started cussing out the chatbot, right? And so Dialogflow will capture that as a negative sentiment based on what you've inputted, you know, as what's perceived as a negative. And then that can actually trigger either a human to come into the conversation and say, hey, what's going on? You know, how can I help you? Sorry about that, right? And that'll usually help solve the issue. And the user will not have had a bad experience, you know, at the end of that conversation. And then the other way to analyze that from like a bird's eye view, and as well as getting really detailed and nitty gritty, is with the analytics platforms available. So right now I'd say the best one available is called dashbot.io. And this platform can literally capture almost everything you could want to know about a conversation and what's happening in the conversations with your bot at large. So one of the main functionalities that I really like is being able to see or filter a certain phrase or word. So say someone said, like, you know, screw you to the bot, right? You can actually see what people were saying before that phrase and what they did after that phrase as well, so that you can get some context as to what they were doing inside of the chatbot before this negative thing happened, and then what did they do after that, right? If a human came in, or if they just left the chat, or if they try to start the chat over. So you can see all those options. And then based on that and based on the numbers as well, since it'll give you, you know, how many people did this and how many people did that, then you can improve the conversation and experience as well by offering more options, you know, decreasing certain options at certain points in the conversation, maybe adding more of an onboarding process if it seems like users don't know what the heck they're doing inside of the bot. So all of that can be captured really easily with the analytics platform Dashbot.
So we know when Andrew curses out a Lego chatbot, we know exactly what happened.
Well, I don't know if that's their internal system, so I can't promise that they'll give you a good experience there. But, you know, ideally, that's what will happen. And unfortunately, with a lot of big companies, they just, one, cannot handle the amount of messages coming in, which unfortunately, you know, there's not a whole lot that they can do about that. But two, you know, it's really difficult for you to be able to analyze and manage that many messages. So with enterprise, it's tough. But I think all the enterprises that have been having a chatbot for, I'd say, the last year have done a good job so far. And Lego in particular, they've done an amazing job. But I don't know what their customer support option looks like, or if they actually even have one, because a lot of these enterprises just don't have an option.
So kind of as we wrap up the year, what are some of the trends you see for next year, for 2019? Like, what are some of the new anything around new chatbots, or my opinion is, like, I think internally for enterprises will be huge. Like, you know, IT support, things like that. That should be a big trend. Like, what do you see?
Yeah. And actually something that came onto my radar this weekend was Salesforce Einstein bots. So this is totally different from Facebook Messenger. But I actually didn't really know that Salesforce was doing this, where they've created a chatbot that, based on my understanding, and don't quote me on this, but they have developed a bot that will help teams internally as well as with customer support inside of their platform. So I found that really, really interesting. And it also contributes to the trend I'm seeing overall, like you mentioned, with having chatbots help internal teams more than they have in the past. Because Slack bots, honestly, to me, have been kind of silly. I have never personally used them consistently, just because I'm like, okay, it doesn't really do that much. But I think now, with the possibilities that people have seen and the business results they've seen with using Facebook Messenger bots and the automation platforms that exist, like Zapier and Integromat, which I mentioned, I think internal business bots are going to get much, much better, because people actually know more about what they can do and how to execute that. But also, I see a lot of businesses starting to experiment with Facebook Messenger now that, one, better policies are being implemented in terms of how to message people and when you can message them, which is really huge from Facebook, since it's been about 3 years and now they're finally implementing that, as well as the other platforms that are coming out. So Instagram and WhatsApp I think will grow a lot as well in 2019, just because they're totally new. Now, the problem I see with WhatsApp is that they actually haven't added like a chatbot feature. It's more of like a business account kind of feature where you can go in, create a business account and talk to your users, but there's not a whole lot of automation. So I see them in 2019, probably towards the end of 2019, adding some of the Facebook Messenger chatbot abilities to WhatsApp so that they can actually have better and more automated experiences. And then Instagram's opening up their chatbot capabilities as well, although I honestly don't see that much happening with it initially. They actually have a messaging platform. I forget what it's called. I think it's called Messages or something that's like super vague. But they actually haven't deployed it in the US, so you guys probably haven't seen it yet. But they have it in a couple different countries like Portugal, where they're testing this platform out that is just the direct messaging feature of Instagram, but in its own app. So I see that growing a lot too. And them, again, taking the lessons they learned from Facebook Messenger over the last few years and adding that to Instagram and WhatsApp. And then, of course, there's other platforms and whatnot that are growing, but I think they're more for specific industries or use cases. So Facebook Messenger, Instagram, and WhatsApp, I see as encompassing almost every industry, and particularly B2C. That's kind of what I see for the next year.
Yeah, we have a friend that started a company called KarmaPot, and I find it interesting. And then the reason they said it's a little bit more than just saying, you know, somebody did a good job on a project. I think it's, they have it on Slack and Teams. Mm-hmm. You can say, hey, somebody did something well and they earned karma points. And I see a really interesting social component to bots, especially like in HR. Have you seen applications like that?
We have, but we haven't personally built any like that just because our focus is B2C. But I will say something interesting, like you mentioned with HR, is the ability to have HR or like a person managing HR be almost unnecessary with, you know, the implementation of bots, because contracts and all of the things that you go through can easily be created with AI. They're actually lawyer chat bots that are offering a service, mainly in Europe at the moment, although with GDPR, who knows kind of what this will look like in 2019. But something interesting that they've done is actually create chatbots that essentially will build a contract for you, so agreements or anything that you would typically have a lawyer draft up, and then actually deliver that as the end product to a user, collect the payment from the user, and the lawyer didn't have to do anything. So it's really interesting to see those applications. And then how that transfers over to HR is the fact that you could just implement that same thing into, say, a Slack chatbot, right? Where that HR person no longer has to onboard or even really like take someone through all of that. The chatbot could do it and then become the go-to for that person. Because oftentimes, I think once someone joins a new team, like it's up to them and their team members based on the department they're in to actually onboard them and get better at it. They typically don't go to the HR person and say, hey, you know, where do I find this or whatever, because for whatever reason, right? But with the chatbot, it'd be so easy to be able to help someone really get onboarded to a new team, to a new company, especially with bigger companies, you know, asking questions like, where do I find this, or where do I print something, or how do I like order lunch? You know, what's included, all these different questions. Like oftentimes people are too embarrassed or whatever to ask. And so the chatbot really can act as like a guide for anyone from a new employee to someone who's been there for a while, right? And be able to execute repetitive tasks or kind of like administrative type of stuff. So I definitely see that growing more. And lawyers are a good example, like I mentioned, in Europe, as well as OXXO, which is kind of the 7-Eleven of Mexico. They have done a great job of creating an internal chatbot that actually does some of this stuff as well, the HR stuff that I mentioned. So I definitely see it growing, but it just hasn't been done or publicly announced in the last few years too much from any companies yet.
Well, I think that was a great conversation. I really enjoyed that. I think this one last thing I wanted to touch on was security. You know, we're talking about a lot of personal information.
Definitely.
User information that's very specific, credit card information. And so how secure, I mean, we're relying on Messenger's, you know, platform and things like that. Mm-hmm. How secure are these platforms and making sure, you know, like everything's connected? Any concerns there, or is that pretty secure?
Yeah, so I'd say for us, because we haven't dabbled with, and I'll give you an example in a second, with financial or medical or the law spaces, we haven't had to deal with as many security issues as they have, since there are some chatbots in those spaces. But for the most part, I'd say Messenger is pretty secure because there are multiple parties involved that can actually help, you know, keep that standard. Because with Facebook as a platform itself, I know we've seen over just the last year, right, a couple different cases where security breaches have happened or like things from the past have kind of come back and bitten Facebook in the butt. But with platforms like I mentioned, ManyChat and Chatfuel in specific, they are able to create a standard for the space that I think is really improving the overall security of Facebook Messenger as a platform, and hopefully Facebook eventually as a platform, as more features from Facebook can be integrated with chatbots. So I don't see security as that big of a deal with Messenger as it has been with Facebook itself as a platform. What I will say about finance and law is that, interestingly enough, with some of the chatbots that exist on Messenger for finance, you can actually log into your bank accounts and do things that you would typically do inside of a bank app. So I don't know what the back end looks like. Unfortunately, I don't have that information on how they did that or, you know, what that looks like for both Facebook and the banks. But two examples of that are TD Ameritrade and American Express both let you log into your bank accounts. So it's interesting to see that. And if they're on there and they've got a ton of information, obviously, that's a very, very sensitive. I think that's a really good sign that the security of Messenger is at a great standard right now, and that it will continue to be as more banks and more very sensitive information companies continue to join the chatbot platform.
My last question was, has to do with UX as a field. Yeah. So we see it obviously took web and mobile by the storm. Do you see it happening, the same trend where there are people focused on UX of text-based interfaces and chat interfaces? And if you're seeing it emerge, like, what should people do to prepare for that?
Yeah, I'm definitely seeing that emerge. And something that I find even more interesting, aside from just the individual, you know, chat platforms, is that the combination of voice and chat is growing at a pretty rapid pace. And two examples of that would be one with Alexa and how there are certain Alexa devices now that have screens. Alexa has made it a little bit tough to like integrate with other platforms, say like Facebook Messenger. So I don't see that happening super soon. But another example would be Google Assistant integrating with Google Home and all the other Google devices as well, where someone who is diving into just like the bot UX space needs to know that that multimodality feature is going to be a really big part of bot UX, you know, in the coming few years. Because right now there are some people who are taking over UX or providing UX consulting and whatnot for chatbots, but there's not a whole lot that you can, I'd say, do with the chat platforms that exist that, you know, have already established their standard, right? You can't change a whole lot about how Facebook Messenger looks from both a UI and a UX perspective, as well as WhatsApp, Instagram, Slack, Telegram, all of those platforms. Whereas with like website chatbots, as well as this like multimodality thing I'm talking about, there's a lot more flexibility. And so I definitely see that space growing a lot more. And in terms of preparing for it, honestly, I'd say just experimenting with each of the platforms is going to be the key way. There's not really, you know, standard procedures and processes in place just yet. But in terms of just understanding it, I think that's the best thing anyone can do who wants to learn more about bot UX, is just understand more about how Alexa skills are created, right? How that multimodality happens between Google Assistant and Google Home, as well as just understanding the chatbot platforms and how they will eventually be integrated with voice or audio components inside of the experience as well. So there's not a whole lot of advice I can honestly give right now, but I can say that the space is growing pretty rapidly and will continue to for sure in 2019.
Thanks for listening. You can always connect with us at skiplist.com.